That concludes another season of anime. Hey, my name is King.
And welcome back to the Ultimate Review, boys! We did it another 3 months!
How is time moving so fast? I feel like we just did, like, the winter one. Like, I'm currently working on the Kingtanic Anime Awards right now, and I'm looking back at all these openings and endings and reviewing, like, all of the previous content, and I'm just like, wow, the year's already over. How did that happen? And one thing that I thought for a while throughout this anime season that really became true once I started doing the Anime Award nomination stuff is this season sucked. Don't get me wrong, it wasn't horrible. We still had some good shows here and there, but the highs were nowhere near as high as the rest of the year were, and the lows, some of them were lower than they usually were, and some of them were just, a lot of it was just mediocre, and so it was just like, there was no impact left on me from this season, you could say. But for those of you guys who are new, who are subscribed during the season and missed all the other Ultimate Reviews, basically the Ultimate Review is at the end of every anime season, or if I'm reviewing like a big franchise or something like that. I almost did one for the Spider-Man movies leading up to No Way Home. Really wish I did that, I just didn't have enough time to get to do it. But anyways, in terms of just the anime Ultimate Review, what we do is we come together every 3 months after the end of an anime season, and we talk about all the shows that I watched, and then we rank them all, and we just kind of reflect over the past season of anime. We celebrate the ones that need to be celebrated, and you know, we poo-poo on the ones that didn't quite live up to our hopes. It's all in good fun here, it's subjective, I wanna hear what your thoughts are, and I probably didn't watch all the shows you watch. You probably have like 1 to 2 to 3 to 5, however many more shows than I watched. I may have dropped one of the shows that you watched. Maybe you dropped all the shows that I watched and our lists are just completely opposite. I don't know. But that's where the fun part comes in. It would be boring if we all agreed on the same stuff. So just hop into the comment section below. Let me know what anime you watched this season. Did you like this season? Was this your favorite season of the year? It wasn't for me by far, but maybe it was for you.
It's me. I forgot in the Ultimate Review. I don't know how I forgot this. I forgot to mention that this entire video has spoilers in it, so just go in with that knowledge. I'm not gonna try to give anything away, but if something comes out, it is what it is. So I do hope that you guys at least don't care about spoilers, I guess. All right, enjoy the video.
So Mushoku Tensei, this is probably y'all's and mine most anticipated review out of this season based on what my reaction to the first season was. So let's just get into it. And once again, I think that this is going to be the most interesting part of this Ultimate Review, which sucks that I'm putting it at the beginning. Now it's really front-loaded, and the rest of it is going to be a lot of ranting throughout this Ultimate Review just because a lot of these shows were not all that great. And there's going to be a lot of praising too because some of the shows are really good. But this show is different because this show is both, and it's so weird. So I've realized something. I was in the car with my brother the other day, and we were going to the store to get birthday presents for our dad. And in the car, he brought up to me, he was like, you know, Mushoku Tensei has unironically been like your most invested show of the entire year. And I thought about it and I was like, no, because I've been ranting about Mushoku Tensei for the past like 6 weeks. Impossible. Oh wait, he's right. And so this is the entire year's worth of my character arc culminating in one review. This is it. This is the determining factor. Was Mushoku Tensei season 2 enough to sway me on this show of whether I like it or not? Yes, it was. And here's the answer. I like this show. Yeah, good job. But here's the scary part. I like this show just barely. And that is because just like the first season, there's almost an equal amount of good and bad. And when I say good and bad, I mean like some of the greatest anime of the year. Like there are some crazy emotional moments and like amazingly emotional and, did I already say emotional? Great acting and action and directing and animation and cinematography and the score and the sound design and just amazing, even on the writing level, some really good stuff. And then at the same time, in the same show, by the same people, you have utter dog booty cheeks. It's just bad. And I realized what it is, because after looking at seasons 1 and 2, or they're cores, so they're the same thing. They're just two halves that aired at different times. They're not seasons, Israel. Looking at the two halves, I realized that I liked Acts 1 and Act 3. I don't like Act 2 at all. So act one, you have like Rudeus learning the ways of the world. You know, you have Sylphie there and stuff, and you know, his first few meetings with Eris and stuff like that. And I enjoyed it. It's okay. It's fine. Stupid isekai stuff. It's great. It's fine. Then you go to the second arc, which is the Demon Continent arc, I believe is what it's called. And that was where we meet Ruijird, and they go, like, on that expedition, they get lost, him and Eris and Ruijird, and they're just trying to get their way back. And I hated this arc. I like Ruijird. He's not the problem. I just, for some reason, didn't like this arc. I think it was, you took away a lot of the elements that I really liked that came back after they left the Demon Continent. And there were a few points in the Demon Continent arc that I actually did enjoy. Like, there's moments where Rudeus, like, saves, what are they, the cat girls, the dog girls, there's some animal girls right there that got trapped that him and Ruijird went to save, and there's moments of character growth for Rudeus, and I'm like, oh, this is really good. And then you have the moments with him and his dad reuniting, and then him trying to, like, win over his sister because she's only heard, like, bad things about him, and he's like, no, and so he doesn't tell her his name, and then she ends up revealing that she knew the whole time, and, you know, that stuff is really good. I think down to Mushoku Tensei's core, it's about family, because it's about, you know, a guy, Rudeus, in his past life, I forgot his name, he basically, you know, he just sucked at life. And so this whole thing is about him, and it's really magnified in the later few episodes, which is where the show really started to sing for me, except in like the final two and in the final moments the show, we'll get to it. And so this show is just like about Rudeus, you know, getting a family, and then, you know, as we see towards the end, what it's like when that family is taken away from him after he worked so hard to gain it and stuff like that. I find that stuff really, really compelling and interesting. And then you go to what a lot of the Demon Continent felt like to me, and maybe it was just like execution and stuff. Oh, another good episode was when Roxy was, it was like the completely centered around Roxy episode. That was a good episode as well. So it's like, for me, it barely favored on the good side than on the bad, but the good is so good and the bad is so bad. I'm like, how did this happen? How is this not like average mediocre across the board, or like, how do you hit both extremes so much? So if I can finally finish a thought, thank you, ADHD. Basically, when the show is about that really compelling family stuff, I really enjoy it and I really like it, and it probably would have been like one of my favorite anime of the entire year. And then you go to the other stuff where it's like what I found a lot of the Demon Continent to be, and it may have been execution, but I just found it to be just nonsense. Like, it was like, why are we here? Why are we wasting time? There's a lot of these jokes and bits. I don't like the horny jokes in Mushoku Tensei. I mean, horny jokes in anime as a whole, I'm just kind of iffy on. Sometimes they work really well, sometimes they work really, really bad. And I get that that's like the kind of the humor in, you know, in Japan. And I get that, you know, it's kind of around Rudeus's character. But I just don't like it. It's a very dislikable attribute. And I didn't like Rudeus, like, throughout the entire, like, second half of season one, or core one, through, like, 70% of this core. And so it's really hard to get into a show when your protagonist is just so utterly unlikable to me. I couldn't get in with this guy. I couldn't like him. I just didn't. And to me, Eris has always been annoying, and she gets better as this part progresses as well. So it's really just Ruijird. I think that's why I didn't like the Demon Continent arc, just because whether it was execution or whether it was that they succeeded at what they were trying to go for, it just wasn't for me. I just didn't like it. I thought it was just absolutely bad. If the entire show was that, oh, dude, you'd be seeing me flip the table in rage. I'm actually about to do that with what I'm about to talk about next. Okay, the next part of this Mushoku Tensei segment of the Ultimate Review is just going to be me ranting about these final two episodes. So once again, it's like it barely favors good, but the bad, it just misfired so hard in certain areas that I'm like, why did you do that? Like, I was basically explaining it to my friend like this. I was like, it's as if Mushoku Tensei takes, like, they take, like, you have a score, right? And why am I stuttering so much? Stop it. Mushoku Tensei is taking an exam where they have one question that is worth 50% of the points on the exam. Then they have five other questions that are worth 10 points apiece. They opted to do only the five that are worth 10 points apiece, got them all right, and then completely just skipped the 50%. And so it's just right there again. I'm like, why didn't you do the most important thing and then go to the other five and then deal with that? Either way, it's going to be 50% if you if you fail one, get the other, you know? And so they get a bunch of small things right, like in particular, Eris in the final episode, when she's explaining her point of view of what happened in the second to last episode, that final scene. Basically, they get like the five things right where they're explaining her point of view and everything like that. But this is also a visual medium. So a lot of this was, a lot of these five were tell, don't show. But since this is a visual medium, it has to be show, don't tell, which was the 50%. I'm like, it would have been so much more impactful had you shown it. And they did show it in the manga. They just cut it from the anime. And that's what makes me so upset, because it was there and they took it out. You know what they replaced it for? They replaced it for this shot of a wine thing spilling and wine everywhere, because, you know, it's an allegory for all the blood being spilled and, oh, he popped your cherry. No. And this is where we come to what I ranted about for about 4 days after the episode happened, and it's the second to last episode. It's after what Eris does to Rudeus. When I first watched it, I was like, oh, so Eris just, she's completely irredeemable. I don't like her now. But then I went and looked for it. I was like, there's no way from a storytelling perspective, unless it was one of those cases where they just completely misfired again, there's no way that you mess up a scene like that badly when I can tell what you're trying to do and there is a simple fix to the scene that makes it actually good. And it was there. So there's this shot on the screen right now that I'm showing you from the manga. And it is this amazing shot of Eris crying after the deed has been done, voice crack, after they tied the knot, after everything like that, after Eris and Rudeus became one. And she's crying on his arm. And it's very symbolic. Once again, it goes to the show don't tell. It's a show don't tell medium, okay? You can't just tell me everything and expect me to feel the complete impact. No, you have to show me as well. This isn't a book, this is an anime. And so that one shot of her crying, which is literally all I wanted, and I was like, why didn't they show this? And then I saw that it was there. Like, it wasn't like I saw the shot and was like, oh, that would make the scene better. It was like, I thought that that was like a necessity for this type of scene to work. And they just didn't put it in there. No, it was in there. They just took it out. So the reason why this shot is so important for those of you who are just like casual, you know, anime viewers and you don't study and dissect stories so much. And maybe you were, the scene didn't work for you either, or it just barely worked for you like it did for me and stuff like that. Or, you know, maybe you loved the scene and you just wanted to come and hear a different opinion and you're raging right now, typing on your keyboard, wishing that the dislike button was visible so you could dislike the video. Basically, this one shot represents three things. It represents the pain and the regrets and everything she's feeling from the past. So she, in this scene, has just been dropped and revealed so much information. And it's also, we learn in the next episode that, you know, she's jealous of Rudeus. And Rudeus, she was nothing with if he's not there. And then she saw him die. And then she was like, I completely felt like worthless and pointless. And why am I here? So now she's going to go prove herself. So that's one reason why she's crying. The second reason is because of what she just did. I think she knows that what she just did was completely wrong. But, you know, they explain it again in the second episode where it's like, but, you know, it's basically like she didn't know when he was going to die next. So she had to get it in while she still could. Even though my boy Rudeus said no, like on three times, which that's another reason why I like Rudeus now. Good job, Rudeus. You earned your points. You were a good man. You understood what situation Eris was in emotionally. And you were like, nah, I can't do that. And then she forced you into it. I'm sorry, buddy. But you seemed happy about it afterwards. So am I sorry? I don't know. So the first two reasons, again, just to recap, is one, she's regretting and feeling all this pain for everything that has happened thus far in the show and all of her choices and everything like that. The second is currently in the present of what she just did. And then the third is what she's about to do. She's about to leave Rudeus and she knows what that's going to do to him, but she's going to do it anyways. And so there's three things right there that one shot represents that would take, like, what I just did, an entire paragraph to explain. There's a reason why there's a saying, a picture is worth a thousand words. That is all there in one thing. If you show me that one shot, I don't need her to explain it later. I mean, it'd be great if she did, because it adds more to it. But that one shot, that's literally all I need. And they were like, you know, I'm wine. Splashy! So when I saw that, I started thinking, how many other moments have been there that would have made scenes more effective that they took out and replaced for other things? I don't know. Now, I'm going to keep my eye open for this. I know that they're aging things up and stuff like that. And I'm excited to see where season 3 goes, because like I said, I am a fan of the show. Barely. I need them to get their game together and just start executing things in the most effective way possible and to stop misfiring and stop trading things off. Just give me all the effective stuff. Get all rid of all the bullcrap. Because right now, as it is, Eris in particular is the most, like, I don't know how to feel about her. Because right now, everything is inferred. Like, I'm assuming this and this and this, besides everything that she told us, you know. But if that image were there, it's almost as if it's said. It's almost as if it's a fact. And that's the beautiful thing about this visual medium, is you can just show that type of shot of her crying, and I probably would have been like, oh my gosh! And then, you know, Eris is like one of my favorite characters of the season. Mushoku Tensei gets like, you know, a 7 out of 10 or something. But they were like, nah, the wine. And so if this keeps happening, I might just end up switching to the source material, whether I do the light novel or the manga, because I've actually seen the manga, but from what I've heard from people who have read the light novels, that it was also handled better there. So I might just switch if this type of stuff keeps happening, if the anime keeps undercutting its own big emotional moments, because this stuff, like, that scene is brilliant. Like that scene literally could be amazing. But they just misfired so hard in some of the most important areas that I can't give it its full credit, you know? Anyways, there are other anime we have to talk about this thing. And yeah, I am a fan of Mushoku Tensei. I can't wait for season 2. I hope that gets announced. How many times have I said season 3? However many times I've mispronounced things, I'm sorry. I know that a lot of you guys are like OCD about that. No, call it its right thing. I don't care. Okay, I will say that Mushoku Tensei Second Core or Part 2 or heck,
season 2.
It is painfully average. Whew. With that rant out of the way, I hope we can get into something good now. Oh god. So Mieruko-chan, as you can see, I got my Hogwarts alumni shirt on because, you know, Mieruko-chan has some spooky things in there, and like in Harry Potter, you know, there's like Dementors and those are pretty, okay. So Mieruko-chan, look, I know that a lot of people really enjoyed this show, and that's great if you did, except for the fact that you're wrong, okay? I'm not even gonna like try to understand, okay? This show was just bad. This was just dog butt cheeks, okay? This is just bad. This has probably been like the most I've felt like I've wasted my time the entire year, I think. Maybe? If not, it's pretty darn up there. And for those of you guys that managed to dodge the bullet and did not watch Mieruko-chan, basically this show is just about a girl who can just out of nowhere start seeing demons. In the first episode, she starts seeing like the spirits and the demons. And she's like, oh my gosh, why can I see them? And we're still wondering that now after the show ended. The biggest problem with this show is it makes absolutely zero progress in any way, okay? Like, if you went from the first episode all the way to the final episode, there is nothing in there that you missed other than me being like, hey, so this character is now their friend in the group. Got it? Okay, that's all you need to know. Then you can just watch it. You don't need to, like, there's no plot points, there's nothing there. And there's anime where that's the case, where you could just, you know, go from the beginning to the end and be like, oh, it was fine, but there's enjoyable episodes in between. Here, it was just a pointless waste of time that I was just waiting for the plot to get started. And here's another thing, they marketed this as, like, a horror spooky anime show. And, you know, we don't get many of those, so I was really excited. It was coming out in, like, September, so I was like, oh, we're gonna have it throughout, like, the entire holiday, Halloween season. That's gonna be fun. But this show was, like, more, I don't know, a horror show was more interested in looking up Mieruko-chan's pajama shorts than actually, like, showing, like, demons or trying to scare us. And so I'm sitting here, and I'm like, I'm watching the first episode, I'm like, okay, we've seen girls changing in the locker room, and, you know, the camera being all up in their business, we've seen Mieruko being like, hey, I'm in my pajama shorts that are really tight for some reason, camera's all up there, too. And then, like, throughout the entire episode, her friend Hana, who eats a lot, you know, they all up in her bazoinkas, and it's like, where are the demons? What is going on here? Like, I'm struggling to figure out what they were going for. Usually, I can gauge that pretty well. I can be like, okay, this was where their intention was, and this is where they went astray. I can't figure that out here. I'm literally just baffled. I'm like, why did they put the demons in the show? Now, who knows? Maybe it's better in the manga, light novel, visual novel, whatever the source material is. Maybe it's better in that, but I can't judge it on that because I've only seen the anime, and this has given me no inclination to go and check out the source material. This show literally has the same set of events every single episode, like beat for beat. It's the same thing. Oh, Mieruko and Hana, they go out on a, like, a friend thing. You may get a clip of them at school or of her at her house at the beginning, but that's not the point. You know, most of it is just them two hanging out, and then, oh, look, there's a demon where we need to go. Oh, let's go the other way. And then they go and continue their day, and then the same demon shows back up, and they're like, oh, no, what do we do? And then Mieruko has to figure a way out of the situation. Same time, every time. Now, they do introduce things that it's like, okay, this could progress the show a little bit, but they don't do anything with that. They introduce, like, this old woman who, like, specializes in, like, you know, magic prevention and stuff like that to, like, protect you from the supernatural. And each time Mieruko puts on, like, these beads that are supposed to stop the demons from getting to her, they immediately explode. And so the old lady's like, oh, this is serious. And then nothing comes out of that. There's this other girl that meets with them that becomes a part of their friends, like I was talking about earlier, and she's like, I can also see the demons. And so you're thinking, okay, maybe since she seems like she's known about this stuff longer, maybe she can explain, like, what the heck is going on. Nothing comes out of it. It was basically like I watched the same episode 12 times and it never added anything to it. It wasn't even like Groundhog Day where it's like a different, like, set of events. It was just like the same thing. Just the same, like, they copied and pasted the script and then just changed a few lines here and there. Oh, instead of this restaurant, let's go see a movie or whatever over there. Instead of her in her bedroom, this is us at school. It's just the same. I'm like, guys, what is going on here? And for you dedicated Mieruko-chan fans of the source material, I know that I'm speaking blasphemy, especially to, since she just won, what, like, number 10 best girl of the season? Or did she get number one? I don't remember. I am now coming to you as a humble... I'm egotistical. I'm coming to you as a self-centered anime fan. Is this what the source material is like? That's basically what I want to know. Is the source material like nothing happens? And that might work in, like, if it's a manga per se. If it's just like a chapter, you know, each week or each month. Where it's like, ooh, what's the random thing that's going to happen? Even though it's the same thing again and again and again. I would like to know, you know, how faithful this was. Is this better than the source material? That'd suck if it was. Or am I the crazy one and this show is secretly brilliant? Let me know in the comments down below. That's pretty much all I can say about Mieruko-chan. Basically, because I've erased everything else from my memory, and I finished watching it like 2 days ago, so I don't even remember that. I'll tell you, my facial hair growth in between the clips in this Ultimate review is more interesting than the episodes in this show. Long story short, I will say that Mieruko-chan is an abomination. The world's finest assassin gets reincarnated into another world as an aristocrat. Yeah, that's right. I didn't even have a script. That's just all off the dome. If I were to ever, hypothetically speaking, give a worst anime title award, this show would get... What is happening to anime titles at this point? They're just becoming like sentences. Like, the synopsis of the show has just evolved into the title. Like, you know, it's like you're having like a pitch meeting and the person who's pitching the show, this is like the synopsis. He's like, oh yeah, the world's finest assassin gets reincarnated into another world as an aristocrat. And then the person's like, oh cool, that sounds like a good show, let's make it. And then they get to the title stage. What do we call it? Well, I mean, the synopsis was pretty good. It kind of tells everyone what it's about, you know? But to be fair, it is stuck in my head. Like I'm surprised that I have it memorized. It's kind of like Higahiro, how that full name was like Higahiro after being rejected, I shaved and took in a high school runaway or something like that. I still remember that name, even though I remember almost nothing about the show. So maybe they are onto something. Also, the Hogwarts shirt also works for this anime because this anime in the isekai world has magic and, Harry Potter has smashed. Okay. So the world's finest assassin is another isekai. But it's actually an isekai. No, there's nothing special about this. I enjoyed it. That's something special. That's an anomaly for the isekai genre. Now, is this show good? No. Is it the worst isekai or even like show of this season or of the year that I've seen? No. Is it somewhere in the middle and did I enjoy myself? Yes, I did. Now, I actually was optimistic going into the show because I was like, oh, that's a cool premise. Like, it's actually it's business. Like, this is actually important. It's not just someone died and they got hit by truck gun and then they wake up on like this new world and they're all powerful and they're the protagonist. It's like literally the world's finest assassin, James Bond, was just like murdered and now he's just in this isekai world. Now he gets magical abilities. He's the most deadly force in the world. Totally makes sense. Now, sadly, this anime could not escape from the isekai tropes that come with the genre just inherently. It's like the baggage. It's just what comes with it. You know, you take a little bit of taking yourself a little too seriously. You take a little bit of harm. You take a little bit of incest. You take a little bit of action. You take a little... The perfect mix for the isekai genre. What's that? Oh, yes. Yes, I did say incest. Yes, exactly. Yes, there is incest in the show. Woo! Ah, don't you love being an anime fan? Day in life. It's like, this isn't even surprising to us anymore. Like, this is just part of it. Oh, there's incest in the show? All right. And it's not like Mushoku Tensei incest. It's basically like Mushoku Tensei, Eris and Rudeus are second cousins. And here, Lugh and Dia are actually cousins. They are first cousins. Like his father, or no, his mother's sibling is Dia's parent. And so they're right next to each other. Then they find out about this information and they're like, ah, it's fine. It'll be all right. Now, with all that out of the way, I enjoyed this show quite a bit. Now, are there some moments where, like, a lot of isekai, it'll just try to take itself way too seriously? Yes, and to this anime's favor, it does deal with a lot more serious subject matters than other isekai do, where a lot of isekai are like, no, this is a serious moment, even though this premise is, this should be a comedy, basically, an action comedy, where it tries to take itself seriously. No, we're this drama. We are Lord of the Rings. They're not Lord of the Rings, by the way. I also do appreciate them trying to tackle such a difficult subject matter, like the child trafficking thing. You know, it sucks, and it's a part of the world, and then after Lugh saves them, you know, they basically kind of forget all about that stuff, and then it's just like, oh, back to incest and harem and isekai tropes and stuff. And it's like, no, I liked what you were doing, go back, stop! And so I wish the show were more of that, where, because they do introduce it, and what they do, and so a lot of the times it feels like this show is like three shows in one, like you'll have that really dark area right there, and then other times you'll have, you know, the normal isekai stuff, and then other times you get this really cool assassin anime, and so it's like three things that they're trying to put all together, and they don't really mesh as well as they're trying to, and maybe that comes down to concept, or maybe that just comes down to execution. Whatever it is, I think that this could have used a bit more work, and yeah, I mean, overall, I still enjoyed myself watching it, but yeah, I think that you could have picked one of the routes and then just chosen to go in that way. I prefer different routes over the others. Like, I prefer that assassin and then dark child trafficking show where he's out there to assassinate the people that are doing this horrible stuff. That's awesome! Who can't root for that? That's basically, like, Taken in the isekai form. And then basically, like, Mieruko-chan, my biggest problem with this show is that nothing progresses. It's literally, like, 12 episodes of setup for something that we haven't even, like, seen the slightest bit of a payoff. And it's not even like a good setup. It's literally like, this feels like the first, you know, 30 minutes of like a movie. And it's like, 30 minutes? This is 12 episodes. This is 4 hours. This is 4 hours of content I'm watching. But now the difference with Mieruko-chan is I actually enjoyed these episodes for the most part. And actually just, you know, I had a good time laughing with the boys while watching it. I've said it in Mushoku Tensei, I gotta say it here. It's a bit weird that you have, like, in his past life, he was like, what, 70, 80 when he died? And then he's now isekai'd, and he's now trying to date this girl who's not only his cousin, but she's also, like, underage. And I get that at that time, she's now an adult, and they even, like, made a whole thing about it. Like, hey, you're at the age, you need to go find a wife, you need to start having children. He was like, I'm 14. But I mean, I get that that's, like, you know, that's the way things are in that time that he got isekai'd to. But it's like, you come from a time where that is taboo and that's not acceptable. Like, I don't know. Like, if I got isekai'd, I'm 19, almost 20. If I got isekai'd, I'm waiting until they're over 18. I probably am. That's just how I've been raised. That's the world I've been in. And I don't know. Maybe I'm just talking. Maybe I would. Who knows? Maybe. I don't think I would. I doubt it. A lot of the times when this happens in isekai, it just feels like the writers forgot that they were isekai'd and they forgot that they were an adult. But you know, it just comes with the thing. It's part of the it's like the price tag. It's part of just the things. It's like tax. It just comes with it. Overall, I enjoyed this isekai. I'm looking forward to season two. Hopefully we can get to all killer, no filler, and start getting some of those fights that we were, like, they were really teasing us in this opening. This opening's so cool. I'm waiting for all this payoff stuff to happen, and nothing happens, so that's fine. But in the meantime, I will say that the world's finest assassin gets reincarnated into another world as an aristocrat is a lot like eating McDonald's. It's not good for you. But it's fun. So, blue period. See, the thing about this one is I'm wearing a blue shirt because the show is called... I made too many puns this video. Let me just say this up front. This is the best show of the season. Congratulations. Which I guess is kind of a good thing and a bad thing because it shows what, to me, at least to the shows that I watch, what the peak of this season was. And in comparison to the other seasons, it just kind of shows the massive drop in quality that we, like, witnessed. Also, I guess the theme of this year is blue because, like, all the main characters, like, or each show is kind of associated with blue. Like, when winter ended, my favorite show was Wonder Egg, and then when spring ended, my favorite show was Vivi, and then when summer ended, my favorite show was the first half of Aquatope, and now this is Blue Period, so it's all blue. But anyways, Blue Period is about this guy who, you know, gives up his bad life that he was living, where he was kind of just, like, doing nothing with his life. He was just kind of having fun, living in the moment. And then he finds a passion that he has, which is painting and art and all that kind of stuff. And then he really goes and tries to pursue that. And, you know, as someone who tries to follow his dreams and tries to make each moment in his life count and tries to do what he loves, this anime really spoke to me. Now, the biggest problem with this show is that it kind of does a lot of what the other shows in this season did, where it kind of just dilly-dallies in random spots throughout. Like, there's about a 5 to 6 episode stretch where it's literally they're just in the classroom learning different techniques and stuff, and that's great in the grand scheme of things, you know, that comes back later in the finale when he's doing the exams and stuff. But in the moment, it's like, but the story's not really progressing. Sure, he's learning one new thing each episode, but I think that they could have, like, done that a bit faster. Maybe learn about 2 things each episode, like compress each episode into a half episode and then do 3 of those instead of 6. And then, like, you know, have the other 3 to actually, like, progress the plot or something like that. Because while it's not bad, it does feel very stagnant at a lot of points. And I also think that this anime delved into some really interesting stuff that just comes up when you're doing anything art-related, whether that's movies, you know, books, or in this case, paintings and stuff like that, where they're talking about the different techniques and, like, what art truly is and, like, how, no matter, like, you can be like, oh, it's objectively this and that, but it's not, because objectivity and art are just complete polar opposites, where everything is subjective here. And so that was something that he really had to learn, where everything was sort of black and light, black and white. What? Come on, I'm trying to be deep. Wake up. Everything was sort of black and white from where he was going from at the beginning of the show. And then he's sort of entering this world where everything is like, everyone's just, like, expressing themselves, and there's nothing set in stone, and you can do basically anything as long as you're not lazy and as long as you're, you know, giving your all to express that. And it's like, that's really cool. There are also some really cool characters in this. I wish that a lot of characters, and I felt like this is one of my biggest problems with it feeling stagnant, is that while it's never bad, I think that it could have gone so much deeper, especially in exploring particular characters that I really would have liked to see more of. Like, for instance, I would have liked to see more of characters like Ryuji and Maki, and maybe even like Yotatsuke or Haruka or other characters like that, that were kind of just inserted here and there and only there as, like, plot devices, which I get at the end of the day, it boils down to characters are plot devices in order to progress the story for, you know, the main characters and what the story is actually about. But I would have liked to see these characters actually become more believable instead of just like, hey, we're here just to give Yatara this one thing that he needs for this one episode in this one instance, and then we're gonna leave. Particularly Ryuji, because I feel like their story was so impactful to me and so... like, I just wanted more of that, and they just didn't want to give it to me, and so every time they gave it, I was like, ooh, yes, this is really good, this is really good, give me more of this, and they were like, you know what? We got 6 episodes of training arc, and so part of me kind of wishes that this was 24 episodes, so that way we could spend more time with everybody, but also I think that that would be too long for a show like this, so I think 12 episodes is the right amount, but I think that they should have had better pacing, I guess is what it boils down to. Also, the show is really creative. I love the animation. I love the music. I love what else? I love the way it shows art in this show. I love the way that, like, not just like on the page, but sort of like his process behind it, and even like in the sketchbooks, and you'll see it from other people's perspectives. And I really like that kind of stuff, where, and particularly in the final few episodes where they're in the final exam and they're painting a nude model. It's really creative how he goes through like three different stages of how he's going to go about this. And then each time he changes it, and you see like the approach completely change, like the animation and the music style will kind of change a bit with it. And I thought it was really interesting to like kind of go inside of an artist's head and then sort of portray that in this as well. It was a lot like, what's it called? Keep Your Hands Off Azekin last year, where that was sort of like a love letter to anime. This was just sort of like a love letter to art in general. And overall, I really did enjoy this show. I think that a lot of stuff could have just been maximized. I think all of your baseline stuff is there. I don't really have any problems with the show other than the fact that they didn't maximize everything they could. And so at the end of the day, I think this is just a solid show. If you got time to watch it, you should go watch it, but don't like make room in your schedule for it. If anything, I might say read the source material. I don't know how much better the source material is. I know that it was it's popular, and I know that a lot of people think it's good, and I can see why. I'm assuming that this was a faithful adaptation. I don't know. And I will say that Blue Period is fine. My Senpai is annoying. Now, I'll be honest, going into this show, I thought it was going to be bad. I thought it was going to be like Nagatoro, but the roles are reversed. But this wasn't that. No, this was actually good. I already know how much hate I'm gonna get for that statement. This show is just a really pleasant watch. It's not trying to be anything special. It's not trying to do anything groundbreaking. It doesn't take itself overly seriously. It's just there to be there. It gets the participation award. Woo! In all seriousness, I think that's selling the show a bit short. To me, this show is just very cute. As you can see by all like the anime trending sites and stuff like that, this was always up there with like the romantic side of things, where it was like couple ships or best couples or best boy, best girl, whatever. This always, at least one character from the show was up in there. And that's because this show is very adorable. It's just very wholesome. It's very nice. It's not the funniest thing ever, but you know, you get to enjoy all the characters. They're all pretty endearing. And so when they get put in situations that aren't the funniest ever, you still enjoy it because you enjoy the characters. Now, like with a lot of other shows on this list, there is very little plot development within each episode. It's like a bit more than Mieruko-chan has, but overall, the episodes are still more enjoyable, so that incites you to watch the rest. So if you like go from episode 1 to episode 12, I think there's 12 episodes, you might need a little bit of explaining of like, okay, these characters are now dating, these characters are almost dating, this character, the grandpa, and you know, you might need a little bit of explaining there. But overall, you'd still be able to follow along really easily, which made it, you know, fun whenever I would watch this every week, and then every now and then I would have friends watch it with me, or I would watch it by myself, or, you know, whoever. And like with Mieruko-chan, there's not much to talk about, because I don't have anything to rant about. I think that this show is just fine. I think that this show is enjoyable. I think that this show is fun. I think that this show, like Blue Period, if you have time to watch it, and this is up your alley, if you like the cute, wholesome stuff, I think you'll enjoy this show. There's just not much to say about it, other than that's not true. I will talk about the main couple. So not like the main two characters that are going to become a couple, but like the main couple, like the couple who's actually a couple throughout most of the series that they focus on. So like the main couple, you know what I'm saying? I'm talking like Sakurai and Kazuma. I think that they were absolutely adorable together. They're so cute. I like that they never like put a label on it, because they were like just a little too shy to do so. It's just a very cute thing, you know? I mean, there's not much, like I said, there's not much to say about this show. It's cute. I was trying to think of other stuff to say about that couple, and kind of just stopped at cute. So if you like cute things and wholesome stuff, I think this is right up your alley. You should go check it out. I will say My Senpai is Annoying is fine. And that's it. I mean, that's not everything, of course. We still have one more thing that we have to do. We gotta rank all these. So we are on Tier Maker. And as you can see at the bottom, I have all the shows in here. I actually have a few that I need to put in the dropped section. So there we go. So as you can see at the bottom, we have Mushoku Tensei, Mieruko-chan, Assassin Anime Blue Period, and My Senpai is Annoying. And right off the bat, I'm going to get rid of Supreme, God Tier, and Fantabulous, because this season doesn't have any of those. So we'll start with Mushoku Tensei. Like I said, it's so weird. It's not every day you find a show that just has so many absolute extremes. Like, this is just so, so good at times, and then so, so bad at other times. Like, it's weird. Like, take half of the show, and I would see that, and I would be like, yeah, that's like a top three anime of the year for me. Take the other half of the show, I'd be like, yeah, that's like a bottom three anime of the year for me. And it's so weird that it's so far in those two extremes instead of being just good and bad. It's like outstanding and god awful. So it's weird, you don't see this that often. So I think this is the definition of painfully average, because I really, really want to just like love Mushoku Tensei so much, but I need them to get rid of all that bad stuff, and I'm hoping that we can evolve past that in later seasons. So for me, that goes in painfully average. Then we have Mieruko-chan, and like I said, this just felt like probably one of the biggest wastes of my time of the entire year of the shows that I've seen some bad shows this year. This isn't the worst show I watched, but this is the most I felt like nothing happened. Like, I literally just watched a show for 3 months where it was the same episode each time, just with a different, you know, template on it, different face on it. And so it's just, I can't recommend this to watch, like, even like out of like, I think some people will like it. It seems like people do like it. I just don't understand, and I don't know how. And yeah, this goes into abomination for me. Clearly the worst show in the season for me. Then we go into the world's finest assassin gets reincarnated into another world as an aristocrat. And I like this show. I think that this is a bad show. Not bad, but you know, a mediocre show that I enjoyed a lot more than it's actually worth. So that would go in McDonald's for me. And then we have the two best shows of the season. We have Blue Period and My Senpai is Annoying in that order up there, which were consistently good and just, you know, passable, not, you know, super crazy in terms of quality, not offering a bunch of super unique ideas. Blue Period, I think, could have been amazing. Like, it could have reached those higher tiers, but it was just kind of okay with just being good. And you know, I mean, I still like it, it still gets a thumbs up for me. I still think it's good. I still think that if you have time and you're interested, you should go check it out. I just think that there's so much it could have just like excelled on that it was just kind of passable, like turning it in. It's like a really smart student who just decided to do a passable job on an assignment instead of like doing the absolute best like you know they can. And that's just what it kind of felt like here. Well, anyways, that's the tier list. Actually, I should rank these based on this. And I think this is good. So going from left to right, top to bottom, we have Blue Period, My Senpai is Annoying, The World's Finest Assassin, Mushoku Tensei, and Mieruko-chan. And of the shows I dropped, 86, Platinum End, and Tact OP. That is the order, the definitive order. I'm just kidding. Let me know what your guys' order was in the comments down below. Let me know what shows you watched that I dropped or didn't even watch at all. Let me know how wrong I am and that Mieruko-chan is a masterpiece. I can't wait to see it. Well, anyways, guys, that's going to do it for this fall 2021 Ultimate Review. It was an insane year. As the season was still fun to talk about. I just think that the content was just so vastly inferior to everything else we had seen. And I guess that really does extend to just how good of a year this has been for anime. What a year for me to like actually like, you know, delve deep into anime. It's been a really good year. Now, of course, there's also been some really bad stuff throughout and you know, but you know, there's also been some really, really amazing gems and some really outstanding shows that I think are really amazing that we will appreciate at the Kingtanic Anime Awards on January 30th. Well, anyways, guys, that's going to do it for this video. If you want to see what anime I'm going into the next season with, if you want to kind of prepare for the Ultimate Review with me, watch the shows I'm watching,